There were walls around us. By the cross he came and broke it down. He broke it down. There were chains around us. By your grace we are no longer bound. No longer bound. You called me out of the grave. You called me into the light. You called my name and then my heart came alive. Your love.
All my fears are gone. chosen me. Love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins, and I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
You split the sea so I can walk right through it. My fears were drowned in perfect love. You rescued me so I will stand and sing.
I am a child of God.
Yes, I am.
The Savior of humanity, unto us a child is born. He shall reign forevermore. Noel,
Son of God and Son of
You know, this morning we are gathering together. I'm going to have our scripture reading here in just a second from the Gospel of Luke. And I just want to kind of reaffirm to you, part of one of the things that we sometimes do, often do, part of our service is, we make our beginning in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And I just want to remind you what that is. Yeah, I mean, think about that a minute. We're saying God above sent his Son down to the earth and the Holy Spirit into our hearts. And that third song that we sung, that I love that song. You know, it's God wrapping his arms around us. You know, and that's what we're saying. You know, in the name of the Father and Son and the Holy Spirit, we're saying, God, Trinity, wrap your arms around us and pour out your love upon us. So we make our beginning in song. We make our beginning in acknowledging God, our Father, and Jesus Christ, our Savior, and the Holy Spirit that comes and dwells in our hearts and has brought us to faith and continues to keep us strong in that. And so I just wanted to kind of relay that to you to remind you. Tim, would you come up and would you share the gospel reading with us this morning? We have a mic. There we go.
Our gospel message this morning can be found on page 857 in the book of Luke, chapter 2, verses 22 to 40. Again, it's on page 857. And when the time came for the purification, according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male who first opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and this man was righteous and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came in the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child, Jesus, to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, that you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light of revelation to the Gentiles, and for glory to your people Israel. And his father and mother marveled at what was said about him. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, Behold, this child is appointed for the fall and rising of many in Israel, and for a sign that is opposed. And a sword will pierce through your own soul also, so that thoughts from many hearts may be revealed. And there was a prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was advanced in years, having lived with her husband 7 years from when she was a virgin, and then as a widow until she was 84. She did not depart from the temple, worshiping with fasting and prayer, night and day. And coming up at that very hour, she began to give thanks to God and speak to him, to all who were waiting for the redemption of Jerusalem. And when they had performed everything according to the law of the Lord, they returned into Galilee to their own town of Nazareth. And the child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. This is the good news.
This is great news.
Please be seated. Kids, if you'd make your way on out. Pete, you got your podium there?
I got it.
You got it handled. You're introducing, and I don't want to ruin this.
That's
like
right.
I did at the first service, kind of. You're introducing a new sermon series. So that's all I'm going to say, okay? All right.
Good morning. Boy, we got more people here than I expected. I thought after Christmas, everybody, I'll just sleep in this Sunday. But I'm glad you're here. I am glad you're here. We are indeed going into a new sermon series, and it's called The Big Reveal. I'm going to go into that, so bear with me. And it appears, like I said, we got past all the hustle and bustle of Christmas. We made it through 2018. We've only got a couple of days left in the year. Praise God. Praise God. Did y'all have a good 2018? Yeah, some of you. Some of you are going, eh, could have been better. But you know what? The fact that you're here today, the fact that you got through the year, the fact that God got you through the year, it's wonderful. Praise God for that. I'm glad you made it. I'm glad I made it. I had a wonderful year. It's just God was there every step of the way, and he was there for you also. And know that in your minds and in your hearts. Because of that, the fact that you made it, the fact that you're here this morning, it made it a wonderful year for you, whether you realize it right now or not. And I hope and pray that 2019, the year ahead, will be every bit as much a blessing for you. And like I said, we are beginning a new journey this morning, a new sermon series with the interesting title of The Big Reveal. Are you all familiar with this term, the big reveal? Okay. Maybe you watch one of those home improvement shows like Fixer Upper. Anybody watch Fixer Upper, Chip and Joanna? A few people. Yeah, okay, good. Where at the end of the show, there's a big suspenseful moment where Chip and Joanna, the hosts, show the new homeowners what has been done to the somewhat rundown home that they purchased. Knowing that through the magic of reality TV, the screen is rolled away, and there in front of them is a completely remodeled and renewed home. It's a wonderful and suspenseful moment for both the owners of the home and for the audience. Let's take a look.
Charmaine are looking for a fixer-upper here in Waco, Texas, in a neighborhood called the Sanger Heights area.
We've shown them three houses. Two of the houses cost more but require less renovation. One house is a complete wreck, but it gives them the most opportunity to make it exactly what they wanted.
We went back and forth, some heated exchanges. In the end, we went for the ghost house? What would we call it? The catastrophe house?
Yeah, you call it the catastrophe house.
It's really hard to imagine it being something new and beautiful. I trust Joanna. I know she's been able to turn crappy into happy, and I'm hoping that she can do that with this house.
Are you guys ready to see your fixer-upper?
Let's go.
Oh, oh my God. Is this the same house?
Oh, man. That's incredible.
Wow.
There were so many elements of this house that when you ripped off the porch, which was in complete disarray, and the landscape and the trees.
I'm not hearing a word you're saying. Oh my God. It's beautiful.
It really is.
Everything is awesome. I can't believe it.
Let's go inside
Let's go see your fixer-upper.
Welcome to your home.
Oh my goodness.
What do y'all think?
Wow.
I know you remember that beautiful banister. There were a few pieces that were missing.
Yeah.
Clint literally came in, one of my carpenters, and he did brand new spindles to match the old ones. He did a
My dream is to hear a knock at the front door and it be Chip and Joanna Gaines. This is my dream. You know, expecting couples also do the big reveal these days. They have a party or a family get together and with much joy and much suspense reveal to family members and all present whether they're going to have a boy or a girl. And how wonderful, what a wonderful thing, how wonderful is that? And some of these reveals can be quite elaborate and quite festive. A new life, after all, is coming into the family. It's a new life to be celebrated, and who wouldn't want to celebrate that? When Martha and I started our family, we didn't know if we were going to be blessed with a girl or a boy, and quite frankly, didn't want to know. Personally, I felt it was a little like peeking at Christmas presents. But now, as the father of two and the grandfather of one, I realized knowing ahead of time might have been a pretty awesome thing. We could have gone for blue or pink instead of yellow. We could have planned a nursery more geared to whether we were going to have a girl or a boy. But we learn by experience, don't we? Okay, so what is this big reveal that we're talking about in our sermon series? What is this sermon series all about? Starting this morning, Pastor Ron, Pastor Andy, and myself are going to be going and looking at all the major events in the life and ministry of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ as God the Father revealed them to us in the Word. And if it is God who is revealing these things to us, friends, this truly is a big reveal. We all know what happened with the birth of Jesus. This should be the first big reveal in the life and the ministry of the Messiah. But you know the funny thing about it? Almost nobody saw this. Jesus was born in a stable in the little town of Bethlehem. And it is kind of ironic that Jesus was placed in a manger that was actually used to place newborn lambs until they could get their legs and start moving around. The only people around that saw this big reveal were the shepherds tending to their flocks at night. The angel appeared, as did the heavenly hosts of angels, singing and praising the birth of the Son of God. The shepherds in the field saw what was happening, but you know, it frightened and it startled them and it shook them up. All of this is suddenly happening after 400 years of what essentially was dead air. If you've ever worked in the broadcasting business, radio, television, you know the term dead air. Dead air is not a major malfunction. It's not equipment failure. Dead air is just simply no input. No input. No one is saying anything. For 400 years, there had been no word from God. No prophecy. Nothing. Then with the angel coming to Mary and the consequent birth in the manger of our Savior, we are on the air again, and now we're going strong. Many big life-changing things are going to be revealed in the next 30 years, one right after the other, as Jesus grows up and his ministry indeed goes into high gear. Okay, so let's move ahead a little bit now, pick this up. We're going to go 40 days after the birth of Jesus. We find Joseph and Mary journeying to Jerusalem to comply with the law of Moses, bringing the baby Jesus to the temple for purification. Jesus has been born, but few have seen him to this point. The Messiah is now being brought to the temple to comply with God's law as the first big reveal of the newborn Savior that many people actually witness. When Mary and Joseph brought Jesus to the temple, they were welcomed by two very old people. Many of the Jews were eagerly awaiting a mighty and magnificent king who would lead the people to glorious victory against their enemies. But there were others just looking for a just and godly Messiah. These people were known as the quiet of the land, For they spent their days in prayer and worship of God, waiting patiently for the day when he would send his chosen Savior to earth. Here, we are introduced to Simeon and Anna, who were two of the quiet of the land. They had waited many years to see God's promised Messiah. As soon as they saw the baby Jesus, they recognized him as God's deliverer and knew that their dreams and hopes were fulfilled. You know, it's interesting. Christmas, the season of Christmas, does not end on December 25th. After Christmas and Epiphany, the actual end of Christmas is 40 days after we celebrate Christmas, February 2nd. Joseph and Mary have come to the temple how many days? 40 days after the birth of Jesus for the rite of purification. In Luke's birth narrative, in Luke 2, Mary is the first to be told that Jesus will be the Messiah. Luke tells us that Mary treasures these words that the angel speaks to her. But Mary, at the same time, is puzzled by this message. She is perplexed when the angel greets her, and she must ponder, as it says, the meaning of his words. This is actually in sharp contrast to Simeon and Anna, two elderly people who happened to be in the temple when Joseph and Mary bring Jesus. At the temple, the Holy Family is first approached by Simeon, who has been told by the Holy Spirit that he will not die until he has seen the Messiah, which was the one thing that Simeon prayed for in his life. Simeon has come to the temple on this day at the prompting of the Holy Spirit, who told him what lay ahead for him, the big reveal for Simeon. Simeon approaches the parents and asks if he may hold the newborn child. Somewhat startled and perplexed, they handed the Christ child over to him. Simeon holds the child up and says, "Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and glory to your people Israel." Having seen the Messiah, Simeon will die knowing that he has seen the Savior, the King of Kings, and he has received God's big reveal, God's promise that he will see the Savior and will die with his heart full of the peace of the Lord. But the first big reveal, it's not finished there. Anna now approaches the Holy Family. She too recognizes the child is the Messiah, but she has a different reaction. And she's coming at this, keep in mind, she's coming at this from a totally different angle. Luke 2:38 tells us, "At that moment she came and began to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem." Anna is also old. She is 84 years old, but she did not share the same mindset and thoughts as Simeon. Anna was not ready to die yet. Like the disciples who will follow her, Anna was driven to bear witness to what she is seeing. Mary was the first to have the good news announced to her, but Anna was the first woman to fully understand and proclaim the good news, which is Christ the Lord. Anna was considered a prophetess and is the only woman in the New Testament described as such. Unlike Simeon, Anna was not just visiting the temple for one day, but she was there for her entire life. According to Luke's account, Anna never left the temple, but worship there with fasting and prayer, night and day. Her husband died after only 7 years of marriage. She may have had specific religious functions at the temple, but Luke does not shed any light on that for us. He does not tell us. All we know is that she has been at the temple all this time. Luke, in his writing, may have considered Anna as the second witness in or around the temple, which was needed to validate Jesus's significance. Deuteronomy 9:15 stresses the importance of having two witnesses to validate an event for us. And this is, of course, the big reveal again. The pairing of Simeon and Anna is one that should be noted for two reasons. First, Simeon represents the Old Testament viewpoint. He represents what has been in the past. Anna, on the other hand, is more representative of the new era, the New Testament. She is the new and living voice of prophecy. In this new age, with the birth of Jesus, the living voice of God will continue to speak about his Son, our King. So, with this big reveal, the groundwork has been laid for the life and ministry of the Messiah. Anna recognized immediately upon the Holy Family entering the temple what Mary, the mother of Jesus, took more time to understand. It was on Mary to raise this child. And she might not have been able to bear up under the pressure of knowing fully that her son was the Son of God. Mary did indeed have much to ponder and to learn, and all too soon would all that she was tasked with as these things prepared and increased her faith as she trusted God's plan. The first Christmas and the Christ child came at a particular point in time. But for many, including Mary and Joseph, the significance of the event is only understood completely over the years to come. 30 years from the birth of Jesus to the written account of the true start of his ministry on earth will now pass. During that time, Jesus learned the trade of carpenter from his father Joseph and taught God's word. But the prophetic insight into God's intentions is the gift which keeps on giving and renewing the people of God as we study and learn God's word. At the start of this long line of insights and big reveals stand Simeon and Anna, one satisfied that prophecy has been fulfilled and the other pointing to the future, a future bright with the promises of God through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. As we celebrate the coming new year, I strongly, strongly encourage you to look ahead with renewed hope and blessed assurance in knowing that the Savior, the Messiah, is the big reveal for you also. Remember that in the Holy Word of God, the Bible, there are words of guidance, peace, love, comfort, and there are answers to every question and every concern in your life. In the sacrament of Holy Communion, there is the life-giving body and blood of our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, that fills us, it renews us, and heals us every time we take it. In holy baptism, you enter into the family of faith. The Holy Spirit has entered into your mind and your heart and your soul, guiding you through all the years of your life. Friends, indeed, this is a big reveal. It's the biggest. It's because of this big reveal that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ has come to save us from sin, from Satan, and yes, even ourselves, to give us eternal life. So, I could use Chip and Joanna to show up at my front door. I'm blessed with a beautiful house, but I'm not going to turn them away if they show up. But I do praise God the Father for the big reveal of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. May God bless you in the year ahead. Friends, if you've got God leading you, it's going to be a wonderful year. Amen.
Will fall, prison shake at the sound of Jesus' name.